Jazz defines a great part of American history. This style of music, which comes in many subgenres, is considered to be the classical music of America because jazz's roots came from the slaves working in the cotton fields. Jazz, which is unique for its spontaneity and its focus around improvisation, was different from European classical music. With the help of the newly invented radio, jazz became the mainstream music in America during the 1920s. Most of the jazz being played was by African Americans. Most famous at the time were Jelly Roll Morton, Duke Ellington, and Louis Armstrong. First Great Migration, where nearly 2 million African Americans moved from the southern states to the northern states, turned cities like Chicago and New York into culturally diverse places. Though the southern states were under the Jim Crow law, which segregated the colored people from the white people, the northern states were still segregated by economics and culture, albeit not by law. For example, the Harlem neighborhood in New York City was occupied mainly by African Americans. A turning point in America's society changed with the introduction of jazz. With America's mainstream music being essentially African American music, there was bound to be a shift in the way the former slave class people were viewed. With jazz greats becoming revered by people across the country, regardless of their race, the 1920s was dubbed the Jazz Age. With jazz's popularity, the middle class white people in America were becoming more interested in African American culture. Despite the fact that the Jim Crow laws did not pertain to the northern states, before jazz, there was no reason for black and white people to mix. Now that the white people wanted to hear live jazz, which at first was provided mainly by African Americans, jazz clubs began to open up in large cities like Chicago and New York City. One of the most popular jazz clubs was the Cotton Club. Opened in 1923 by Oney Madden, the head of a New York gang and an active anti-prohibitionist, the Cotton Club was established in the heart of the Harlem neighborhood, a mainly African-American part of town. With the, quote, aristocrats of Harlem flocking to the, quote, stylish plantation environment of the Cotton Club to hear black entertainers. For the first time in American history, white people were paying to watch black entertainment. Celebrities, politicians, and other high-class white people came to the renowned jazz club to hear greats like Duke Ellington, who performed with his Cotton Club Orchestra for 4 years. The Cotton Club's success in the 1920s was due to the lineup of great musicians and the desire for people to hear the live music and see the African-American Cotton Club dancers. With the birth of jazz came changes in the social scene. Since jazz was initially dance music, the Charleston was brought to the limelight. First appearing in the all-black cast show Running Wild, the Charleston, a dance which incorporates quick movements of every limb of the body, became the it dance. Soon, both black people and white people were dancing the Charleston to jazz hits. Another social change was brought more subtly through jazz, racial integration. Though not by law, jazz clubs such as the Cotton Club and Connie's Inn were restricted to only white people, but kept their entertainment black. Though jazz brought these people together in one area, the interactions between the two races didn't always blend smoothly. When Duke Ellington played at the Cotton Club, he had to ask the doorman for permission to let his family and friends see his shows. Louis Armstrong, despite the happy and smiling face that has made him the icon of early jazz, the trumpeter had to face many difficulties with racial injustice. He even made lyrics to his song.
My only sin is in my skin. What did I do to be so black and blue?
Later in the 1950s, Armstrong refused to play at a gig at a hotel in Arkansas, in which he wasn't allowed to sleep in because of his skin color. He then commented about the segregation in the Little Rock schools, saying, quote, "It's almost getting so bad, a colored man hasn't got any country." Some white musicians who wanted to join this new entertainment business sought the help of African-American musicians. At first, it was all done in secret, because if the public realized that white people were working hand in hand with African Americans, both the black and white musicians were socially outcasted. However, due to jazz becoming a shared attraction to both white and African Americans, racial injustice was becoming noticed on both sides.
To prove that jazz can bring together white and black people, Harlem's Savoy Ballroom was opened in 1926 by the joint effort of white and black entrepreneurs, and unlike the Cotton Club, was open for both black and white people. On the opening night, people were turned away because there wasn't enough space in the 4,000 maximum capacity ballroom. The Savoy was an immediate hit with both African Americans and white people. Though the group of party growers were usually 85% African American and 15% white, it was sometimes split 50-50.
That black and white walked through the door together, Savoy. They were joined by a simple thing called swing. We fought a war with music and dance, and that's what opened the doors.
In 1935, soon after the Jazz Age, Benny Goodman, a white band leader, created the first distinguished mixed jazz band, as he hired colored musicians like Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton. The Jazz Age, bolstered by the creation of the radio and popularized by its diversion from European classical music, is a trademark of America. Most importantly, however, jazz facilitated bringing white and black people together. Though it didn't directly solve racial injustice, by creating a common medium between colored and white people, jazz helped spark the long trek to creating a country where people of every race and color could enjoy the same music, sports, and everyday opportunities and rights.